they have the damage to take these turrets. Unicorns above might be in the LCS.
In July, we weren't even thinking about LCS. Like, there wasn't even the possibility that we will have the chance to try to even qualify for it.
Unicorns of Love, welcome to the LCS!
I would say joining an organization is like the easier way, I would call it, because you don't need to organize that much from your own. So we decided for Unicorns of Love just because we wanted to hold on the name, we wanted to become an organization.
Setting up the organization was task. I wanted the best for the people, so I actually asked my father, who had a company himself.
I went to my bank and I said, okay, I need a bank account. And they said, okay, we can open it. What's the name, I say, of the bank account? I say, Unicorns of Love. And the people were, they were professionals, so they only hesitate for a second or two.
That my family is so supportive is an incredible feeling, just for me personally.
I think it's something we both were interested when, on the moment we saw the streams. This is because it's a team, they're smart, they're very good, and I think this is the difference why we said okay. And I think this is a very good school to go through for later careers.
We are an older generation and you sometimes don't know what your kids are doing, but when you are interested in that, you'll be surprised. It's interesting and you should support them.
When we started talking about a house in general, it would be great to actually like sit down and eat together. It's a perfect plan to just learn how to cook a few meals.
I still think it's really good to be a bit away from home. It's just a learning experience for me. And I can obviously grow individually a lot from this.
Now you actually have to be here, you need to do all your chores, you have to think about all the stuff you're doing because you actually live with other people in the same house, same room. And I think it's really good, especially when you're kind of young as we are right now. You learn a lot. Since we're kind of new blood into the LCS, hopefully we can actually bring a bit of new spice.
I think it's actually our playstyle. We are willing to risk a lot of stuff, pick new picks, and just go aggressive on the map. We really trust each other on every pick we make. For example, Kiki's TF jungle. You might think he's crazy or something when he first announces it.
It's really great that people might not expect something, or they expect something weird, and then we play normal, and then they just say, like, oh, they play normal now.
Unicorns! Unicorn!
We believe in each other and in our abilities to play the game. We are like really close friends in real life. And it's important. It helps in the game a lot, I think.
I feel really confident and I trust in all my teammates. And I'm comfortable where I am right now and wouldn't want anything else. Yeah, I think a lot of people might actually find inspiration. Like how we as five people doing this for fun actually managed to get into the LCS one day.
Absolutely fantastic sentiment right at the end. People might be inspired by this team. They do something they love, find out they're good at it, and they race all the way to the LCS. They didn't even think they were going to be in the LCS in July.
No, but they did burn a pancake. So that was kind of sad.
That's what you focus on.
But they put Nutella on it, so it's okay. Now you know how to become a Unicorns of Love. Just eat a lot of pancakes with Nutella.
Oh, guys, welcome back. We are about to get into game as the Unicorns of Love will be taking on Giants. It's a 1-1 Unicorns taking on a 2-0 Giants. These two teams, they're still settling into their positions in the LCS, still trying to figure out where they are. Let's remind everybody of the lineup starting with the Unicorns of Love. We just saw a video feature on them, and these are the players. Vizzy Chachi up in the top lane, Kickus in the jungle, Power of Evil in the mid lane, Vardags and Helisang as your AD carry and support, and of course, Sheepy with his dad's help opening the Unicorns of Love bank account as the coach.
That is really cool. I mean, their support he gets from his parents here to start the whole thing, start the organization. I really think that was cool.
It really, really is. Let's get back to serious notes. Vizzy Chachi, we heard earlier today from him saying he's not going to give Wurlib the freedom or the ability to do what he did last week. Wants to shut down Wurlib's Jax and, of course, Power of Evil in the mid lane. He started off strong last week, didn't really shine in the latter parts of the week, but these are the two guys in my mind that we'll be looking at to carry UOL.
Yeah, whenever you saw Unicorns of Love before they got into the LCS, it was all about the two solo laners, Power Fever and Visi Charger here. So it still is. I mean, they're fantastic players. Yes, okay, the Orianna didn't work out for Power Fever, but difference between him and the mid laners Pepe Nero has faced so far is going to be massive, because Pepe Nero, he faced Soren, typically a very passive mid laner, and of course, a Blizzard on the side of MOM here. So we should see Power Fever control him, and make sure he can roam to the top lane here and help out Verlib, of course. And talking about Giants and their lineup, we have them on the red side in this game here in the top lane. We have Verlib, we have, of course, Frederick in the jungle, Pepe Nero as the mid laner, we just talked about him here, Adri as the support, and Rydal. Oh, sorry, Adri as the AD carry, Rydal as the support, and of course, Losak as the coach for the team.
So the question for me about the Giants is, how good are they really? In my opinion, this is going to be their first real test. Unicorns of Love showed up against some slightly stronger opponents, in my opinion, and Giants, you know, they went 2-0, but it was against, you know, weaker opponents, at least in my opinion. Werlib and Frederick were the two that got them going last week. I don't think they're going to have the same freedom this week.
No, again, there should be more pressure on these two guys, especially Werlib. If he gets Jax again, don't let him just have a free lane. Don't let Frederick, don't let Pepe Nero roam up there. Have your own jungler camp him, shut him down early, because we have seen a Jax being shut down, and I want to see what Werlib can do if he doesn't get that great start where he's like 4-0.
Yeah, we have to find out. It's something we were talking about earlier today as well in our players to watch. Werlib being a guy that when he gets a camp from his jungler, can steamroll a match, but when he gets camped by his opponents, he just face plants and burns. I do want to quote something just before we jump into picks and bats. Last week, there was an interview with Adri, and he said, we didn't even expect to pick up wins in the LCS. Now we're 2-0, and we're going, what do? We need to see if their mindset will be affected, because Rocket had a similar mindset in summer, and they struggled when they lost their confidence. So, we are into picks and bans. Xerath Jarvan taken off the table from Unicorns of Love, targeting Frederick and Pepe Nero. Pepe Nero famed for his Xerath play leading up to the expansion tournament. In reply, Cassiopeia and Sivir.
Yeah, so two target bans here in the mid lane, and of course Jax being banned away here against Werlib. So we're gonna have to see him on a different top laner. Gnar still left open, could be the pickup for Giants if it's not gonna be first picked by Visi Chachi, who I do believe actually himself said, whenever Gnar is open, I want to play him because he's so good on him and because Gnar is considered such a strong pick here. So I want to see if Giants will ban it or leave it open.
And of course, last week, the win that Unicorns of Love did pick up was with Chachi playing Gnar.
All right, that's going to be Gnar.
Final ban is Thresh. No question about it. You don't get more of an insta-lock than that. And Gnar secured for the Power Ponies.
So a Thresh banned here by Giants. It was actually the go-to pick for Rydal last week. He played it twice. He first picked it twice as well for Giants Gaming. So banning it away this time. Not sure if they were expecting Unicorns to actually take it. And maybe hoping they could get a Gnar if you take Thresh for Hillisang, who's known as a very good Thresh player himself. But why would you ever take that over Gnar anyway?
Well, I've got another question over and above the supports is, what is Frederick going to play in the jungle? Last week he ran Vi and Elise. Jarvan was banned by Unicorns of Love. Obviously those two champions are up. Kick has played Jarvan in both of his games last week. Lee Sin is still up and available. And Rek'Sai is available as well.
For the first time.
So let's see if either of these teams feel it's pick worthy.
But again, I mean, we have so many of these power picks open, we don't even bother talking about them because we know both teams here have the option of picking multiple ones on the side of Unicorns of Love, or sorry, on Giants Gaming. Annie slowly becoming actually the number one support here.
I wouldn't even say slowly. I would say the de facto support.
You have Janna, but the teams don't want to play disengage here in Europe at the moment. They want to play all in engage. We heard Lulex on the analyst desk here after his game for H2K saying, we just wanted some engage. I mean, we want to fight. We just want to go in. We don't want to sit back and wait. Same for Giants here. Thresh will band away. Rydal will get his Annie. And of course, LeBlanc for Pepe Nero, one of his strongest picks, one of the picks he used in the expansion tournament as well to really get Giants Gaming in the LCS.
Yeah, performing at a really high level.
There's Rek'Sai.
We do see Rek'Sai locked in. That is the first time here in Europe. Vardags will grab himself a Corki. He played Sivir twice last week. So we're going to see her. Rek'Sai is a lady.
Of
Please
course.
Keep me in track because I said he earlier today. I'm going to see how well Unicorns of Love can sync up with the presence and the lane control that a Rek'Sai offers. His mobility from his ultimate
yes.
really going to allow him to keep keep everybody on Giants in line across the map.
She gives so much map control, not only because she has a global ult to herself as long as she set up the tunnel, but also because, again, when you're underground here, you can spot where the enemy team is moving around. You get these small circles popping under them, and your entire team can, of course, see it. So you don't even need a ward placed if you want to try and catch someone out here or avoid being caught. So Rek'Sai just offers so much for the team, and also, of course, fantastic damage, great wave clear, clear in the jungle. Combined with some good ganks.
Well, Giants Gaming are signaling they wish to point, click, and delete somebody. With Vi, Annie, LeBlanc, and that Super Mega Death Rocket from Jinx, Giants are looking to eliminate a target, and they have a ton of tools to do that. But if they don't blow that person up, this could get scary. Power of Evil, maybe going something like a Lulu to help balance that. We'll find out shortly.
You don't have much defense on the side of Giants Gaming here, not much disengage. It's either go all in or just end up dying here. So it's, once again, we're going to have these setups where it's who can engage first and who can lock down a carry and just blow him up before the fight even starts, and then you're going to win it. Because Giants, on their side again, it's comfort picks for the carries. Atri, he's a great Jinx player, used to play it so much as well back in the Challenger Series, and getting it once again, and you have this burst combination, you land the ulti, of course, and then you get your reset or you get your passive proc, then you can just keep chasing down these kills. So very, very all in by Giants so far. Let's see what Unicorns want. I mean, Janna is open if you want to disengage, but she doesn't work that well against the Vi because you cannot stop Vi from going in. So you have to time it with the ulti being connected, target landing down on the ground, then you have to pop your monsoon, and that just doesn't buy you enough time when a LeBlanc falls, when a Tibbles follow, and of course, Jinx with the rocket.
So we'll find out what Rydal or what they're going to lock in.
Well,
but on the side of Unicorns of Love, Hillisan going to Leona. Played it last week as well. Actually got a 7 KDA on that champion. Was not particularly impressive in lane. However, once we got to the mid game and the team fight, solar flares for days. But also another aggressive team comp from Unicorns of Love.
Yeah, and you get the Kassadin counterpick to LeBlanc in the laning phase. Kassadin has a very, very good time against it because, again, you have your magic shield, you can freely farm. She cannot poke you down. She doesn't have the mana to kill you through your flask, through three potions as well here. So good lane matchup for Power of Evil on this Kassadin. Make sure he gets the Rod of Ages fairly early. And then again, you have that mid-game spike of a Warrior Enchant Rek'Sai and a Corki to make sure you can take fights there, clean up with the Kassadin, shoot him towards the late game. And once again, both teams are just really looking to team fight.
It's the flavor of the spring split, I feel, when you look at the team comps that we are seeing. Maokai, the final lock-in, is available this week. Once again, we are playing on patch 5.1 with Maokai and the Zrot, the ZZ Rot portal up. Giants Gaming have got a whole heap of lockdown and single target focus, but I think that Maokai is going to offer a fair amount of team fight tankiness, but Giants still have to deal with a lot of very, very mobile champions from Unicorns of Love.
And for Giants here, going into late game, it's going to be so much about Atri and how he can position himself on Jinx. If he doesn't have a flash ready, there's going to be a stun coming in from Hillisang. His ulti is going to land in his face every time. Gnar falls in, Rek'Sai, everything pile onto him and kill him before the fight starts, because you're running a double damage threat from Giants with the Maokai, so they are going to beat the target here, where of course Gnar tends to offer a bit more damage in these fights here. But that's actually been when we watch Gnar against like a Sion. Maokai himself, not too shabby, at least in the mid game, it's okay damage.
Well, we did see those last closing seconds, both of the respective coaches, Sheepy on the side of Unicorns of Love, Lozark on the side of Giants, giving their team some advice. One of the things that I really took away from talking to the coaches here and watching the NA coaches was hearing how the players and the coaches were saying in those last couple of seconds, getting some hints, some tips.
Yeah.
Remember your vision, remember your decision making, how you're going to play out. This is, of course, the team comps. As always, guys, hop onto Twitter. Vote and tell us who you think will win. Hashtag UOL win or hashtag GIA win, rather. Unicorns of Love and Giants. Less clear cut this game, I feel, DeFicio.
Mm-hmm, agree.
And it's going to be exciting to watch. We're loading up into game. It is UOL versus Giants. Game two here in week two.
Yeah, let's look at Giants comp again. So much is going to evolve around Atri and this Jinx, because if he gets to late game, and you have a Maokai as well, and of course Vi actually has quite a lot of damage as a jungler in the late game. It's not a bad setup for them at all. Rek'Sai normally, when we see here, goes Warrior Enchant into full tank. So obviously, there's quite a beefy front line though for Atri to try and shoot his way through in both Gnar and Rek'Sai. Joined obviously by Leona as well.
Atri played Graves in both of his games last week, had a 13 KDA. So he has the ability to carry. Now we just need to make sure that he can do that while he's got the support of his team. Whirlib is hanging about, but a sapling toss, so there's no CC, but here comes Rydal. Gonna stun Vardex up. Is he in trouble? May have to start with Valk. That's a flash, actually. Vardex had already skilled his Foss Bomb, but that's really important, knowing that you're gonna have the potential of a Vi plus Annie engage, even the Flame Chompers from Jinx. Vardex is gonna play super careful in lane.
Just gonna have to sit back and farm. No real reason for him to go aggressive though, the Corki Leona lane. Unless they could get the early level 2 onto the likes of a Jinx on Annie. Again, two immobile targets. So while we talk about how Corki has no flash, I mean, look at the side of Giants here. If Leona ever gets the engage onto them in the laning phase and Kikis come down on Rek'Sai, you have the knock up, you have the stun, you're gonna kill either Annie or Jinx every single time. So both bottom lanes here could be a target for the junglers, and we actually see them as well start on the top side of the map. So moving down towards this bottom lane, once they do have the double buff, we could see some action very, very early on.
Well, I'm really glad you actually bring up the presence of Kikis, because one of the reasons that Whirlip was able to just sort of snowball ahead last week was how limited interaction his opponent's junglers had in his lane. Whirlip was gifted free lanes, you know, frequently in both of the games, and Kikis is not the type of jungler to let that happen.
No, and even better also for Kikis, he's now playing a jungler with a global ulti, which means he can set up his tunnels, and you have to do this pre-level 6. You need to set up defensive tunnels, one close to the top lane, one to the mid lane, one to the bottom lane, and obviously at your camp as well, so you can move between them very, very fast. But you need to be able to gank the bottom lane and quickly move to the top side if someone like Frederick shows up there, and suddenly you can be part of ganking or defending two lanes almost at the same time on this Rek'Sai. We're going to see how he uses it. Hillislang wanted to go aggressive at the level 2 here. I actually think Rydal managed to last hit the Grump, and Audrey didn't get any XP from it because he's standing down in the Tribush doing it. The Giants didn't really get a chance to go for an all-in when they both hit level 2, as only Rydal got it.
So we'll see how the engages continue to pan out. Keep an eye on those HP bars. Kikis is very, very low. He went down using the passive to regen up and actually opting to recall. Going to be under vision, so Giants will be aware of it. That's a very good ward placement. The passive, the Fury of the Xerxai. Once Kikis starts burning through some of that built-up Fury, actually regens in the jungle. Still not enough for more than the first clear, though.
No, but we do see for him, he's really going to focus on power farming. He already clears really, really fast on the Rek'Sai, and he goes back after 3 camps, so he will only be able to get a ward. He won't get any potions for it, but he will upgrade his jungle lights and get this 30 gold, of course, and just start really clearing fast. I do expect him to sell his Trailblazer later and swap it over to a Chilling Smite or Stalker's Blade, as that, combined with your nug up and your extra movement speed while you're on the ground, really sets up for some very, very scary ganks.
Interesting build path options available to Kikis. We did catch a brief glimpse there of this mid lane. Power of Evil on the lane matchup that you actually favored, Kassadin into Blanc, finding himself 10 CS down. Pepe Nero off to a good start, considering PoE was probably the more hyped mid laner. There was a lot more excitement around Power of Evil, and he's instantly struggling.
And it's a different start for Pepe Nero compared to what we normally see in this matchup. We always see Doran's Ring and 2 potions on LeBlanc here. Again, the problem for is he can't really trade well enough with the Kassadin and keep a mana up at the same time to really push him out of the lane. But with the flash, he has more mana. Now Kikis going for the first gank.
Oh, there's the tunnel. Got the Queen's Wrath down. Going to be attacking in a second. First blush. All too simple. This is a question we're going to have to speak to Unicorns of Love and Power of Evil about. Was it intentional? Was he dragging his feet? We'll get to that in a second. Whirlip is going to get the gank of Frederick once again. Brief knockup from Visichachi. Flashes 100 HP. There's no red buff, but the denting blow secures the kill. Frederick with an instant reply from Giants. It's not over yet. Now Hillisang's in trouble, forced to flash. Ignite was burning him down. Adrian Rydal continued to chase. Stun comes onto Vardex. Summoner heal burn. 50 HP. The rocket secures the kill. Hillisang goes
Kikis
in. Gets a reply. Here comes Kikis. Knocks up Rydal. Rydal's been slowed. Kikis is spinning. He's winning. He's looking for the damage. Red buff is there. He tunnels. He burrows. He shoots. Rydal gets away.
He walks and he stays alive.
I got a bit excited there, DeFicio. First Rek'Sai
again
for me.
A lot of kills here again. The junglers, they're involved with everything. We keep talking about Frederick and Kikis. They're so active in the early game. Gank in mid lane from Kikis, got the kill here. Pepino didn't use his flash at all. I believe he got hit by the slow from Power of Evil and figured, okay, if Rek'Sai's gonna flash on me here, I'm not gonna get away anyway because I was dropping fairly low. And then obviously in the top side, connect the Q from the Vi, finish up the kill as well from Frederick's side. But man, a lot of action here. And obviously the lack of flash you mentioned at level 1, Varrox ends up dying for it.
So, 2-2 in kills. 200 gold separates the team. Kickers, some successful ganks. He's looking to get control of the crab. Frederick wants to play with him. We've got two junglers, both sporting ranged trailblazers. Look at the support. Kickers does not have flash. Keep that in mind. He throws out the prey seeker. Still going to be unburrowed, or rather burrowed. And he's going to actually use the tunnel to get away. So Giants looking to set something up, but nothing yet. Now Hillisung trying to set up on Pepinero. Remember, Pepe's still got his flash. Not needed, because that went wide. My word, it's not over yet. Whirlip, level 6, going aggressive on Chachi. Chachi's got mega gnar form, but he doesn't have access. Throws down a giant boulder. He's going to get away cleanly. But non-stop aggression across the map.
Every single lane here supports roaming as well from the bottom side out towards mid lane, towards the junglers fighting at the dragon here. It's not over yet. Once Frederick hits level 6, he's going to go instantly to a lane as well. Vardak will have his flash ready, but Hillisung won't if he wants to target this bottom lane.
Well, we'll see what...
Again, you want to get Adri ahead. He's already picked up an assist from that early kill.
Oh, Hillisung. He's got the Zenith blade. Does catch Adri. Vardax has come in. Here comes Kickers. Void Rush throws himself in. Prey Seeker's got a long range. Doesn't connect this time round. Tunnels to close the distance. There's the slow from the Chilling Smite. You called it to Fishy Bro. Flash away from Adri. The engage from Unicorns of Love gets a summoner spell, and we'll see if they can rinse and repeat shortly.
But again, this is what you do on Rek'Sai. Once you recall, you make sure you have a tunnel around the lane where you want to set up a gank. You just instantly use your ulti back to that lane here. You join in. Two people now want to gank Visichachi. We already have Whirlip pushing it down. Visichachi should not be able to survive here.
There is no assault and battery with a knockback from Pepe. He throws him out to the side.
Oh, no.
And the Ignite secures the kill. That was a little less exciting than we were hoping for. It's not over yet. Adri's been caught. There's no flash on him. Keep that in mind. Oh, we'll get to that in a second. Pepe's knocked up. He's saving his distortion. Does get out. Here comes Power of Evil. He's going to flash for it. Does get a kill with the Null Sphere. Now he's chasing down PoE. Frederick's level 5 in reply on the side lane. And the bottom was able to disengage. This is just crazy. 3-3 at 8 minutes.
I really love these two teams here. Every single lane is just roaming around, consistently looking for fights. I mean, Pepinero last week, you could said, you know, Zoran and Belisa couldn't really keep him in lane. Now against Power of Evil as well, he's just roaming here, pushing the wave against the Kassadin, got the kill in the top lane, ended up dying for it as well as the response come. But so much action here, and this is really gonna now be a game where if you manage to use the first few kills you get to get a few defensive pink wards and obviously a few green wards here, and you just light up the river here so you can see every single roam happening, you can predict what's about to happen and you can counter gank it and suddenly turn it into your advantage.
Something that you definitely get the vibe when you watch both of these games is Unicorns of Love and Giants have something to prove. They are both playing very aggressively. They've got team compositions that complement an in-your-face play style.
Yeah, you have no kiting or disengage from anyone. Like, this is just all in for every single team.
Go ham or go home. That's the way it,
basically.
That's the way it works for these guys. A lot of faith in Unicorns of Love, though. Won out their fan vote last week against Gambit as well, which quite surprised me, really. This is a new team to the scene, but they've got a lot of support. Take a look at the tunnel coverage. I do want to highlight that Kickers on this Rek'Sai, she has got her tunnel options, top, middle, and bottom.
Yes, sir.
Deeper in the bottom lane, and not too surprising, because truthfully, Vardags and Hillisung are the two guys who are a little bit weaker than the rest of Unicorns of Love. I think you feel that UOL is about their solo lanes more than the duo. But they're holding even, 0-1-1. Both supports with a kill. Both with options to play with.
Yeah, talking about holding even here, Power of Evil has now caught up in farm. Pepinero sitting at...
Helps when he's gifted first blood.
I mean, sure, it's a bonus. But had a bit of trouble in the start with Pepinero pushing down, but could have just been a bait from Unicorns of Love. And now we can really see the trade from Kassadin. He can do over and over to LeBlanc. Frederick down his bottom lane. We talk about how engage onto the likes of a Leona here. She won't be able to dodge away from it and she will end up dying for it.
Adri's baited in. The solar flare comes down. First victim is Jinx. Can Vardax get away? He's flashed, he's valked, he's healed, he's alive. Frederick is going to think about the dive. Here comes the Void Rush. Kickers is looking to fight. This is now a 2-on-2. Teleport from Whirlip in the background. Hillisung is still in. That was a flash knocker from Kickers.
Two kills.
He's got one. He's got two. Now he's looking for Whirlip. Chachi, he's going to pounce. He gets the stun. Does have Gnar. Gnar's Whirlip into the wall and Unicorns of Love come out. 4-1, I believe, or 4-0.
And every single Unicorns Aloft player just went straight to the bottom lane, roaming from Power of Evil. Of course, Kickers with this global ulti. This is why teams ban Rek'Sai, because she's so strong at her map pressure, map control. She can be everywhere. And he's just really been off to a good start. 3-0-3. Only one kill he wasn't part of.
Great play. Crowd erupts with the Unicorns chant. And 11
minutes. He as Kickers, not as Rek'Sai, because everyone knows
right.
It's a she.
You were right. You were right. You said
Kickers
she.
Okay. He's a guy.
You said
he's a boy.
She. We're just getting a bit obsessed because we get yelled at on Twitter. So this was the counter engage from Frederick.
So I understand why Giants is going for Vardux here, because he's on the Corki, he's the damage dealer, but he does have Valk, he does have Flash, so he can actually escape if you don't burst him down instantly, where Hillisang would be stuck, and just try and get for the one kill, at least see if you can get him low enough, and then be ready to disengage in case happens. You should always respect the Rek'Sai ulti. Whenever you're fighting, if you haven't seen Kiki's ulti in a while, you know there's a high chance he's gonna come down and join, and of course, teleport from Visicharchi. You just wanna be part of it and get one kill at least.
Absolutely no deaths on the side of Unicorns of Love. Now they're gonna try set something up. Frederick has been a little bit caught out. Assault and Battery's not available, but look at the damage onto Power of Evil. It's gonna force him to run away. While we've got a brief second, also look at the itemization of Wurlib's Maokai. Got himself that Righteous Glory as a first item. Oh, they've caught Adriat. He's stunned in place. Power of Evil trying to set something up. Hillisang is alone amongst three, but now he's got the support. Victim is going to be Hillisang as Adri gets the super mega death rocket down. They'll be forced to back away, and Power of Evil went in reverse while Hillisang was going forward.
Yeah, but still, it's the same everywhere, every time in this game. Oh, is there an option for me to go in? I'm gonna go in. And in this case, Hillisang just a little bit too aggressive. Didn't actually see how many guys from Giants were nearby this mid lane. And Righteous Glory, we don't see too often on Maokai, because Rod of Ages has kind of become, or been for a long time, the thing to get on him. You want that extra tankiness, you want that AP as well, just to have a bit more damage on Maokai in these fights. Lane pressure, because Righteous Glory doesn't really give you anything in the laning phase itself, because it's not about the laning anymore. It's about the team bets, and once again, it's about engaging. It's about going all in. Keep in mind, Annie doesn't have the same kind of engage as a Leona here. You need flash, you need some kind of speed up to get in range with the Tippers first side, where Leona has a lot longer range on her ulti to start a fight.
So we'll see if it works out. Wurlib, of course, needs to be with his team for that Righteous Glory to work out. But I like the theory, and it also just keeps playing into the style of team comp that both of these squads have put together.
I think I would prefer maybe a Talisman coming from Rydal instead, and you just try and get as tanky on this Maokai as possible, because it's going to be your job to sit on Vardux all game long here and just keep him busy. But we're going to have to see if we're actually going to get a Talisman coming from Rydal.
Okay, let me theorize here. You've got HP and mana from the Righteous Glory. So you've got the hit points, you've got some natural tank juice from Maokai. I'm going to say this, and I'm going to regret it, but you can get armor and MR from the Zrop portal, ZZ Rot portal, maybe second item. Maybe I'm getting too excited because it's right, available.
Right. ZZ Rot portal is an item you build if you want to siege. These people don't want to siege, they want to fight.
Kickers is going to tunnel. Going in for Rydal. Solar Flare comes down. Rydal's caught out. He's going to be the first one to go down. Not before he's thrown out Tibbers. Doesn't matter though. Support for support as Frederick is going to get dropped. Now Pepe's in trouble. Forced to flash up from the side lane. Idri gets shut down by Vardax. Vardax has got red buff ticking, and once again, Unicorns of Love come out ahead. 1-3 after an aggressive engage.
This is the thing we talked about in champs, like how for Giants, again, you have two damage dealers. So if Adri goes down early on and he's denied or been unable to actually hit anyone because he has to constantly run away, Giants will lack some damage compared to Unicorns of Love. We're just going to see it again here. Pippin Arrow trading on Hillisang a little bit. Notice how everyone is moving except for Wurlib, who's actually on Maokai, sitting in lane.
We come back
well,
to life.
More kills. Who needs replays anyway?
Yeah, not this time around. We did see that Void Rush from Kickers, instrumental. 4-0-5, the first Rek'Sai in Europe, and now you see why it's permabanned in this side of the pond.
And this has been the perfect game to have Rek'Sai in, because there's been action in every single lane, and again, she can be in one lane, then instantly swap over to the next one, join that fight as well, and because all the comps are just purely all in, the damage from a Rek'Sai, especially now in this mid-game, or Enchant Hex Strangler as well, because Kickers picked up all these early kills. If he finds Adri one-on-one, Kickers will destroy him.
So keep in mind, we are on 5.1. So even though Rek'Sai, she took some hits this patch, not 5.2 live, which is taking even further. Look how quickly Kickers can burn through that red bramble back. Got himself a Giant's belt, got two Hex drinkers. Unicorns of Love find themselves nearly 5,000 gold in the lead. They've got two towers to zero. They've got the first dragon. Drake is spawning in a minute. Let's see if Bardex can hold this tower. He's got pretty good wave clear. Basically 1v2. That was a very good defense.
A nice little defense here. Frederick didn't actually show himself in this bottom. He's hiding in the bush, waiting for either Kickers to come in for a gank and then try and kill him, or maybe go straight for Vardax. Oh, spot it out.
Yeah, Freyseeker is going to give Frederick's position away.
Yeah, another good thing
you
about Rek'Sai.
In the top lane, Chachi, Power of Evil, Hillisang, they're looking to chop down the tree that is Whirlip, and that's going to be all too easy. 1, 2, 3. And that's going to be a dead Maokai. A little longer than expected, but they got him done eventually.
So Giant sent three guys to the bottom lane. Doesn't pick up a kill. Didn't even get a tower here due to the defense with Vardax. And then Whirlip was just stuck in the top side. So Unicorns of Love knew they could go for a very safe dive onto him. Knowing three guys from Giants were stuck in the bottom lane. Get a tower as well. So looking very, very nice for Unicorns of Love. And the first game we see where Whirlip isn't like 4-5-0 just from the early game on his top laner.
And during the pregame, beginning of the day interviews, you can see those little footsteps actually from Pepe on the ground. Kickers still targetable despite being burrowed, is going to get rooted up. He manages to close some distance. And Chachi said it, we are not going to give Whirlip the space he needs to get fed and to get ahead. And that's what you see, 0-3-2, even on CS actually with Chachi. So at least keeping himself relevant in terms of gold, but way behind global, not having those three towers to his game. No, or six assists.
And he really needs to get fed in this Maokai here because there's so much damage on the side of Unicorns of Love. If he's not able to go in and buy time for Adrian Pepinero here to find the kills, then Giants won't be able to win the fights late game either. So we're going to have to see if Whirlip can actually just try and get the farm before he really joins in in the team fights, because right now he won't be able to do too much.
And it's actually a super difficult team to itemize against if you are Giants. You've got physical, magic, true, mixed damage from a lot of different sources. So we need to see how Giants actually pull themselves ahead. Looking down the items, Eye Edge and Zeal for Audrey. As you see Whirlip pushing the top lane out, realizing he needs to teleport bottom. Unicorns of Love, they've got a 5-man push. They're actually going to get some damage down. Not before they're forced to back away.
And what Unicorns of Love are doing right now is using the fact that Corki is a lot stronger than a Jinx in the mid game. Trinity Force is completed, BF Sword as well for Vardax. So they're grouping, forcing Giants now to come and defend their towers here and potentially even risk being killed if they want to go for any engage, because Vardax is very, very strong compared to Audrey.
That
right
was
now.
So close from Hillisang. Leona, definitely one of his signature champions to fall back to. Pepe Nero. Still getting pushed away. Remember that Unicorns of Love got the teleport out of Whirlip, so Chachi can push a side lane. And the level of aggression that Unicorns of Love have put on the map, with having the teleport and having that void rush from Rek'Sai, is going to give Unicorns so many options when playing the lanes. But there's no tunnel set up in the top half of the map for Kickers.
No, but just having Rek'Sai allows you to have a jungler who can actually split push, because she will push the waves very, very fast with a Q. And obviously, again, she has the ulti to join in for potential fights as long as you stay around the tunnels. A lot of possibilities for Unicorns of Love when it comes to, again, the mid to late game. For now, Giants decided they want to group themselves.
And I'm just waiting for the engage. Somebody's going to throw something in. If you're looking at Kickers, it's because he's about to rush. He's coming to the tunnel that's behind. There's the teleport we talked about. Is the fight over yet? Solo three against three! Giants are locked up! Giants are flung backwards! The Unicorns of Love are pouncing on them! That is 4-0, and Power of Evil has set his sights on Pepe Nero. PJ Salters, Giants get aced!
What a nice setup here. Giants grouping up, trying to siege down a tower. You can't do it unless you know that you can't get engaged from the flank when you have a Jinx. That's what we talk about, how you can lock her down if you get around her. That was an ulti from Kickers and a teleport, same position. Again, you can teleport to the tunnels as well. That was absolutely fantastic.
Let's see it again, Deficio.
Yeah, let's see it
this
again.
This was quite exciting.
So, teleport and, of course, Rek'Sai ulti from Kickers behind them. Notice the positioning of Adria. He's going to be the target. Solo flare first, and now there's nothing he can do. Triple knockup from Kickers. And this team fight was just perfect by Unicorns of Love.
It was over before it began. The moment Chachi and Kickers were able to get that flank. It's next to impossible to get away from that. That was, I think, a three-man solo flare with two people being stunned. And Kickers got himself, I believe, a three-man knock-up as well with that unburrow. Great performance on the queen of the Xerxi.
Can we just
first
keep her
6-0-6?
Can we just ban her again?
Such an exciting team. Infinity H plus try for all. Mogs completed in the top lane now. Over 10,000, or just around 10,000 gold lead in favor of the Unicorns of Love. Let's see what they do. Chachi's found himself Peppy. They get a lot of damage down and just keep pushing him out. And it's just, it's all been about the Unicorns. They've been very aggressive, as were the Giants, but Unicorns have secured more towers, more dragons, and that's allowed them to maintain control.
Yeah, and they've just been doing a very good job actually pushing the lead in the mid game again before Jinx can scale up, before Maokai can become really tanky. Because basically Chachi is doing the Hexstringer into Warmox we see so often on the Gnar here, and just getting the Warmox early on. If you need to itemize against physical and magic damage, and you just need one item to do it, flat HP is the best. Warmox gives the most in the game, so that's why he goes for it as the second item here. And Unicorns are really just pushing this mid-game lead with the Corki, with the, again, the Rifted Rek'Sai getting all these early kills, and Giants simply don't have enough time to do anything.
And I want to go back to questions that we posed. I know I've said it a whole bunch, but Giants were 2-0 coming into the week. Giants really needed to step up against the Unicorns of Love to prove that they could challenge for those top spots. I mean, the Unicorns really put on a great showing at IEM, and last week, they were okay in many of their games, but they weren't quite as dominant. This time around, Unicorns are clearly displaying that in this matchup, they're several levels above that of Giants.
At least knowing again how to abuse your power spikes and how to abuse your fed carries here with Giants beforehand. Again, we actually saw Kickers and Visichachi split up in like a 1-3-1 beforehand and just use again the teleport and the ulti from Rek'Sai to then start a fight in the mid lane. Now setting up for a fairly early Baron, only 23 minutes in. Not enough deep ward coverage for them to really do this here. They just want to try and see if Giants want to face check them here and start a fight, even though Power of Evil is actually sitting in the mid lane or in the top lane, pushing it in. So for now, Unicorns should wait around just a little bit.
Look how powerful those little footstep pings are for Kickers. Really giving vision of all of the Giants. And of course, throwing out those Prey Seekers while in Burrow form. There's a long range on that Q. I always feel like it should slow, but it doesn't. But that's an aside.
You want to make her stronger?
Dragon spawning. The animation makes me think it. That's
I think her E should also stun for like 5 seconds.
Why not? I mean, is a knockup not better than a stun? So, dragon number three goes the way of Unicorns of Love. They have that 10,000 gold lead. Unicorns were sniffing around Baron, but realize they don't need it at the moment. And the Giants face a gigantic hill to climb, because they are in such a difficult position against this very aggressive UOL team.
Yeah, and again, it all falls on Archery in these team fights now. He has Phantom Dancer completed, so going for the optimal single target damage build. The best damage possible for him on two items. However, he's still a Jinx. He's immobile, who has no help from his team. There's zero peel on the side of Giants here. I'm not even sure Rydal wants to build a Mikhails, even though it's what you normally do against Leona. It was one of the reasons she fell out of favor, because you would go Mikhails and you would just cleanse her ulti when she tried to engage on your squishies in the back line. But I want to see what Rydal, I mean, I think it is the best option when you have Righteous Glory already completed, so you do have that speed up for your team. But I wouldn't be surprised to see him actually invest his money into getting a Talisman, selling his current gold item and switch it over to a Talisman.
So, DeFisher, for the second time today, the top inner turret is the last turret remaining. Peppy's playing with fire. That's very brave. Look at the damage there from one null sphere. Point being, Unicorns of Love have a high, massive lead, and they are pushing this top inner turret, much like HDK were in our previous game of the day. Let's see where Hillisun goes. Where does he want to push? Peppy is, again, really playing with fire, pushing forward, and he's been poked away. There has to be the ghost signal for the tower. Look at Hillisang's position. That's going to keep Giants back.
Yeah, the Unicorns can just keep Giants around this top lane, because look at the bottom lane here. Massive wave has already been built up. It's slow pushing towards forcing someone down to defend it. And even if you send the Maokai, who has teleport, he might not be able to come and join the fight in time when there's so much burst coming in from Unicorns to love and so many engage options.
All right, let's see. Frederick, desperation, assault, and battery. Is he going to go in? That is the question. Got that red buff ticking. Pepe again going aggressive, pushing forward. You have to feel if Giants are going to have any chance of coming back, they need to try and punish. Flash Tibbers plus stun is available for Idle. But Unicorns have just got actually surprisingly good poke with that Corki.
There it is.
There's a flash, the Tibbers. Power of Evil's caught up, and Pepe Neo instantly forced away. Arjun's been caught up by the solo flares. You see Rydal is the first to fall. Instant reply from Vardex, taking down Whirlim with no tree to hold them back. Unicorns of Love get the inhibitor.
Vardex was just sitting ready here, waiting for that flash engage from Rydal. And as soon as it happened, he just jumped away, got stunned by the Tibbers, but he was far away from everyone, so they couldn't actually kill him. And right now, Unicorns of Love, we gotta get two games ending in under 30 minutes. That's pretty crazy.
Let's see what Frederick can do. Assault and Battery goes in, but you can see Unicorns have split. They've taken down Audrey. Frederick is still alive, but not for much longer, as it's Kickers that takes him out. Unicorns get two more kills and another inhibitor. Gonna back away, happy with absolute map control that they've built up for themselves. Few more minutes before they can actually push down the Nexus. But again, just that desperation play from Frederick. Oh, it's not over yet. Pepe eats a boomerang before he's forced back.
So, Kickers right now on Rek'Sai. He's the guy with the second most goal in the game as a jungler. Obviously, 8-0-8, so that's been absolutely fantastic. But we typically don't see the jungler sit on that much gold. And he's just been so fed. And pretty much through the entire game, from the early double kill he picks up in the bottom lane, how he's managed to join in for every single fight, and really, really showing why the teams respect Rek'Sai so much and normally ban it in every game. Again, this is the first game it's open in Europe. And we see why.
Yeah, you see why.
You see why.
Right at the beginning of the day, you said Whirlib was one of our players to watch. What will Whirlib do when he's not given a free lane? When his opponent's strategy is not feed Whirlib and hope to win. 0-5-2, Unicorns of Love have demonstrated they can play around the Maokai, they can play around this very aggressive comp from Giants, and they've just picked really intelligent engages. So Unicorns, again, holding on to this massive lead. I'm not going to try math, but it's many, many thousand gold. Frozen Mallet picked up by Chachi, Baron being started, and if Giants even try to interrupt this, Unicorn, surely you're going to take them out.
Yeah, no chance. You have super minions pushing in two lanes, so you just have to sit back in your base, try and pick up some farm. But it really, I mean, looking at the pick and ban phase, Giants wanted the LeBlanc pick for Pepinero. And I remember back in the expansion tournament how they first picked it when they gave over, at that time, Jarvan and Lissandra, who was considered like two, still are, of course, but really back in the expansion tournament, it was like the two main picks, strongest picks you could get close to it. They took LeBlanc instead as the first pick. This time around, again, they early picked the LeBlanc, first rotation from Giants, giving over Rek'Sai to Unicorns of Love, who of course first picked the Gnar themselves. And now they're going on Audrey, and he's dead.
Audrey is dead. The Unicorns of Love proving Unicorns are not mythically powerful. Three kills for Power of Evil. Deficio, I just want to wrap up that point you were saying. That's PoE going in for the flash, trying to make it a Quadra. First pick LeBlanc, 1-3-2. First pick Annie, 1-5-2. Giving up the Gnar at 2-2-11 and giving up the Rek'Sai at 8-0-10. Unicorns of Love dominate Giants.
Absolutely fantastic.
Kickers just dug them an early grave. There's no way else to say it.
But this
fantastic
game, I mean, 5 minutes into this game, every single lane, someone had died in like a 1-on-1 or 2v2. Like, there were fights everywhere, and it just went in favor of Unicorns of Love here. They had the earlier power spikes with the Corki. Gnar became extremely tanky early on. Of course, Rek'Sai picking up all these kills for herself simply meant that Unicorns of Love could abuse that power spike and keep forcing fights around against Giants here. Audrey on Jinx. Not a fun game to play the AD carry when you know every single one wants to jump you and kill you, and nobody from your team can help you. They can just look at you die, and that's it.
A lot of fan support here. Viewers in the studio chanting unicorns, unicorns, all the way through. Just for some interest's sake, really quickly, most of the members of Giants were around 9,000 damage done to champions. There were carries. For the side of Unicorns of Love, they were closer to around 14,000, with the jungler of Kikis' Rek'Sai dealing 12,000 damage. Only 2k behind his carries. To contrast it, that's more than double the amount of damage Frederick put down. But, you know, when you're playing a damage dealer, Rek'Sai, I feel that in playstyle and execution, Rek'Sai is similar to Nocturne in some ways. You have to be on a carry, you have to be getting kills to be effective, and Kikis demonstrated that. 8-0-10.
Yeah.
Great performance.
And really also, I mean, a difference between Rek'Sai and Nocturne, again, the early pressure you can have as a Rek'Sai, your ganks are great. Keep in mind, when you tunnel in, you don't actually use any ability you need for the gank itself. It's not like a Jarvan doing an EQ combo over a wall and has to wait for it to be ready. No, you just tunnel over, you walk straight in here, you have your knock-up. This game showed, first of all, again, why Rek'Sai normally is being banned, because whenever there is so much action early on, you can just be part of every single fight, but also showed, again, Unicorns of Love, how good they are when they have these chaotic games where it's just constant fighting around. The shot calling seems to be on point, even though they are just yelling random things during the fight. But yet, they're so good at finding, okay, where's Archery here? Okay, boom, lock him down with Leona. Kill him instantly. Okay, next target, and move on.
There's an element of solo queue chaoticness these games.
Just a little bit.
There is an element of it, just in terms of how they pick their fights. And you know, It is quite disheartening for Giants because they actually started relatively well. They got some kills on the board. They traded some blows back. The problem is those blows kept coming and there was nothing Giants could do. They just kept getting hit over and over and over and over and they didn't have an answer. And that comes down to picks and bans. They didn't have disengage. They didn't have a way to deal with the overly aggressive Unicorns.
Yeah, once you fell behind. And also, again, a bit slower scaling on their side. Okay, Maokai and, of course, the Jinx we keep talking about. Simply meant that you couldn't keep taking those fights, but they did, and that's why they fell so far behind. The Unicorns of Love just took over the game. So overall, I have to say, Europe now, compared to like last year where we had some very long games, some games focused around dancing with the Dragon or the Baron for a few minutes or 15 minutes. Now it's just like action from every team.
The most exciting thing to me is the fact that we were anticipating a lot more get five Dragons, win the game type of games. And that's been the exception, not the norm. A lot of teams have shown that they can get a lead by, you know, forcing some dragon fights and then taking turrets, which gives them that small item lead. And they're punishing that item lead so much harder. That's, again, two games in a row, sub 30 minutes, closed out convincingly and decisively. You think of Fnatic's wins last week. Again, convincing, decisive.
And they play next game.
Who would have guessed? Yeah. Giants as well. You know, even in Giants' wins last week, albeit not in 30 minutes, it took in 35, it was still decisive. Yeah. Even when Giants get a lead, they crush as well. The only question is, how do you avoid giving up that lead if you're a member of Giants?
And can Giants also play defensive? Because now they got punished for being a little bit too aggressive by Unicorns of Love here, but we're going to have to see when they play tomorrow.
Yes, we will have to keep an eye on that. For the moment, let's take a look at that game. So in closer detail, let's hand it over to Shox at the analyst desk.
Thank you very much, Quickshot. We're here with Kikis after that stellar showing, the very first Rek'Sai in the European LCS. Congratulations, Kikis. After the 1-1 record and your first experience in the LCS, what was the main thing that you took from that in order to secure your win here?
Well, we are still a young team, and even though we went 1-1, I think that's really great performance by us. Well, not great, but good enough. Elements are still a strong team, and I don't think anyone should underestimate them. And I think winning now is like really great for us, and well, not maybe relieved, but we are really happy.
So you first picked Gnar, and you left both Rek'Sai and Lee Sin open. Was that your plan, that you'd get either Rek'Sai or Lee Sin, or did you know that Frederick doesn't play Rek'Sai?
To be honest, we expect them to pick Rek'Sai. Like, we prioritize Gnar more than Rek'Sai, and we were really surprised to get both. And I think we just win Champion Select and then snowballed from there.
Yeah, indeed, you won Champion Select pretty hard. You got all the OP champions, Gnar, Rek'Sai, Kassadin, for their roles, and then Corki Leona as well, fitting the combo really well. So you must have felt really confident going into that game.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, and it showed. Let's actually get a replay up on the screen of one of the early phases of the game where you guys decide to go bottom and you showcase exactly what Rek'Sai can do. We can roll the clip and you can talk us through what happens here, Kikis.
I think it's a situation that I just tell my team that I can ulti if they engage on them. And Vi comes, I just ulti there and they're really over chasing. They're tunnel joining on the kills. They don't even like notice my ulti fast enough. Mm-hmm. I just go there and clean up the kills for like easy double kill.
Yeah, very impressive here. By now, your AD carry almost died though, so you still made it in time.
Yeah. And then there's both TPs from top laners, but we are outnumbering the Maokai 5v1, so yeah. Not much he can do.
Not much he can do. And Laurie, at this point in the game, you were also saying, well, for this, with the double kill on the Rek'Sai and that move, it's pretty much game over for Giants.
Yeah, like I said, the combo was extremely strong, and when the game is like 6-3, I don't think there was any way they could lose from that point unless if they threw really hard, so.
Yeah, you guys were keeping the play very aggressive. One thing we know is that Giants always likes to focus their attention on the top lane, and they actually did get a couple of ganks off. Were you ever worried that you were maybe giving too much attention to that bottom lane and the mid lane, and they would still get ahead?
I think it's fine. It's definitely not that good to go auto planner O2, but he's still gonna be useful in teamfights. It's not after all, and we can just snowball other lanes and don't worry about that too much.
Yeah, let's actually get another replay up on the screen. It's just beautiful. We have to look at it again. It is fantastic. Kikis, talk me through the game plan, because that flank is so beautiful.
We just knew that they're pushing 5 in mid lane, and they didn't care too much. Maybe like they had no vision on the tunas. They didn't expect me from behind. And me and Chacha are just like, we're going to TP. We're going to flank them from behind. And that's all. Like, we just went with the flow, and that went really good for us.
Yeah, let's roll the clip and see the magic happen for you guys. You're just chilling bottom lane, and then it's on.
Yeah, I was like, I'm going to go bottom in case we can engage mid. I'm just going to ulti instantly. Like, we TP at the same time, and they're split, like, beautiful. Lyanna ult, knock him to three people, and we just clean up the teamfight.
Yep, fantastic. Just to play it out. I mean, you guys were ahead a lot before that, but that definitely sealed the deal for you guys. You were saying in the beginning you thought it was a good result going 1-1 in that first week. How much work do you think you have to go if you want to beat those teams like Elements, like Fnatic, like SK at the top of the table?
Well, as I said, like, we are still a new team, young team. Like, it's first split of the LCS, and we have a lot of things to repair or learn, because we, like, know the standard play, like, go in, just engage with everything we have, but now we need to think more and prepare more for the matches every week.
Yeah, how much, that was something that we talked about before you guys started playing LCS. We love your aggressive style and the way you come out with new picks. How much has your way of preparing changed, knowing that you play the same teams and you scrim versus the same teams?
It didn't change that much, but now we have coach in the house. We are like 6 people, and we can communicate more properly than just through online. We can talk face to face. I think it helps really much. Like, we watch some of the replays, we have our picks prepared, and we just train them in the scrims.
So you guys in the past played like Poppy top, TF jungle. Can we expect more this kind of picks coming from in the future, or it's too top secret to reveal?
We definitely have some picks like in our pocket, but it's kind of hard to practice, because sometimes when we go like a weird pick and we lost, not because of the pick but something else, like some team refused to scrim, but that's just all.
You got to keep that secret and try it on the Rift. Congratulations, Kikis. Fantastic game. We need to step away for a moment, but coming up is a clash between Fnatic and Rocket. As we go, let's hear from H2K's Odowamne on Fnatic's playstyle and how the league will have to adapt to slow them down.
Fnatic definitely impressed me. Like, they were considered underdogs by almost everyone in Europe, and they just showed up with a really good team that has a very unique playstyle, and I think that's the reason they won these two games, because they have a style that they just force chaotic fights. They just get fights out of nowhere and they just throw it in your face, and they just catch you off guard with lots and lots of fights. So when people will start figuring them out, it's gonna get a lot easier for other teams, and they're not gonna be bad, they're still gonna be good, but they're having this unique playstyle right now.